Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد. My dear brothers, dear sisters, respected audience, once again welcome to another episode of Save a Soul Da'wah production. We have a very interesting program, interesting guest. Today's topic, what's under the hijab? I cover my hair, not my mind. A very interesting topic, interesting, wonderful guests. We will chat about Islam and the passion, the love to be courageous to wear the hijab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than those who call to Allah and they do good deeds. And they proclaim, I am among the Muslims. So you are proud to be a Muslim. You are a happy person that Allah guided your heart to Islam. With me here today, two wonderful guests. Later on, we will have another two wonderful guests. We start with Amber and Balqis. We welcome you. Thank you very much for coming to the studio, for really having the passion, the interest, and the love to share your story. Now, Amber, you are 13 years old.
Yeah.
Can you tell me, how did you hear, how did you revert to Islam?
My sister Chelsea, she talked about it a lot with me, and I understood what she was saying and everything, and I really liked what she was saying, and she started talking about converting and stuff, and I really liked it, and so I converted for God.
Very nice. So you felt good about it. You felt natural.
Yes.
So you are 13 years old.
Yes.
And you know, by converting to Islam, you still keep your roots. You still keep your identity. You are still a Canadian.
Yeah.
You are a Muslim Canadian now. So you still keep that great roots as a Canadian. Now, Amber, you know, you've heard some people talking bad about Islam, or the dirty picture that they're drawing about Islam, what's so-called Islamophobia. And did that discourage you?
No.
It did not discourage you?
No.
But you did hear. Did you hear about
it? Yeah, I heard a lot of things. Mm. But you just, it's like when you're little and someone tells you, oh, it's okay to do that. And you, so you do it. But like when you're older, your mind's still like open, but not as much. So I'm still like, I'm only 13, so my mind was open to it. Like, I was really happy.
Beautiful. That's a beautiful thought. So it is a matter of a mind and a heart to be open-minded. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who guide people's heart. And I see you are wearing the hijab. I remember this interesting story, and I tell my respected audience about the day that Chelsea called me, Amber's sister, and she said that Amber, voluntarily, with passion, she want to revert to Islam. She want to declare the shahada, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. I bear witness there is no God, no deity but Allah, and Muhammad, peace be upon him, his messenger. And I said to your sister that fine, that will be a good news. Really, that's a pleasant surprise, a happy news. She told me that she is coming to Toronto in 10 days. And this way you will declare the shahada. Now, I thought 10 days, why should we wait 10 days? Let us capture the happiness. Let us capture the moment. Let us capture the thought of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in our heart. Let's not delay 10 days. And I asked your sister to put you on the phone so this way you could declare the shahada, revert to Islam. But what's interesting, your sister told me something beautiful and interesting, that really you want by your own will, by your own passion, by your own great feeling, that you want to put the hijab, the Islamic scarf, right after converting, reverting to Islam. And I said, fine, let's do it now. But at that time you happened to be in a theater, and your sister postponed it a couple of hours later, right? So basically you felt good about the hijab. Can you tell me why you are wearing the hijab? How do you feel about it?
It feels good. It feels like beautiful. And you do it for God.
Like, yes. So do you think that people will be pointing the finger at you, laughing at you?
Yeah, but see, in the end, it doesn't matter because in the end, you'll be laughing at them.
You mean in the life after?
Yes.
Allah mentioned that in the Quran. فَالْيَوْمِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ يَضْحَكُونَ Today, the believers will be laughing at those kuffar. Now, speaking of laughing, we'd love to really feel good and laugh. We love to have a genuine feeling. That genuine feeling about the hijab, right? You felt good, you felt encouraged before you put it on, but after, do you really still feel good about it?
Yes,
you
of
do.
Course.
I remember Balqis here, she's my daughter also, 10 years old, and I remember your story, how you put the hijab. Can you tell me, Balqis, that day you put the hijab, how did you feel?
Well, I felt really happy, and when I wore it, like, I felt my heart was purified and everything. SubhanAllah, like, it was such a wonderful feeling. And then when I put my hijab on, like, the first time I went outside with my hijab, I was looking in the mirror, and then I found out that there was nur in my face.
You felt there is nur in your face. Wallahi, this is so true. Yes, it is a nur in your face. MashaAllah. Now tell me, Amber, you wore the hijab and now we have the school. So you must have gone to school next day a totally different person, right?
Yeah, well,
that surprise the teachers, the students?
Yeah, I was already new at the school and everything. And so it was like a even bigger shock because I was new. And then like 2 months later, I come to school wearing a hijab. They were all like very shocked and they had a lot of questions. And my teacher, he was like, what? He's like, you're joking, right? I'm like, no.
Not.
Like they were all shocked.
Okay, but what's some of the questions, if you
like,
remember?
Why did you convert? Like, how did you do it? Like, do you have to like get baptized? They asked some funny questions and some sad questions like,
Mm-hmm. That's good, actually, that the teacher also allowed that period to make people have that kind of opportunity to be open-minded and open-heart. Some of the questions, like, for example, when they asked you, how did you revert? What did you tell them?
I told them I did it over the phone.
And
because
okay.
I just told them, all you have to do is, like repeat what the sheer says. Like you repeat what they say.
Yeah, and you know what it means. I bear witness there is no God but Allah and Muhammad, his messenger. You know ahead of time what it means. And
yes.
Now for a person to revert to Islam and for you to wear the hijab with love, with passion, with courage. Really, I congratulate you for your courage.
Thank you.
What's the next step? Are you going to study about Islam? Are you going to study how to make your prayers, the Quran?
There's no stopping. Like you can never learn too much. You can never stop learning about it.
Wonderful. So you started already learning how to pray.
Yes.
You see, my dear brothers and dear sisters, respected audience, we have to know that in Canada in particular, we have a green land for inviting people to paradise, inviting people to Islam, inviting people to the Quran. Let their intellect test, examine the Quran. Let their intellect and their heart absorb the Quran. We have so many candidates out there, good Canadians like Amber and others. They're ready to enjoy the life, honorable life, pure life, moderate life of Islam. Because Islam is about moderation, purification. My dear brothers and sisters, something we have to remember that we have to have a support system for those newcomers. We have to have what's so-called alternative. Sometimes they end up losing their friends, losing certain environment, losing sometimes a family member when they revert. No longer they are welcome at their home. So we should, as Muslims, we must welcome those with a big heart, and we have to have centers to welcome them, welcome the newcomers, support them, give them that wonderful alternative. Amber, let me ask you here, what kind of an advice will you have for the non-Muslim? I prefer to use the term not yet Muslim, because when we say non-Muslim, means we subject them for life. We, they're sentenced for life not to be Muslim. But if we say about them not yet Muslim, it's like, it sounds like one day they will be a Muslim. Even when they hear we call them not yet Muslim, it brings their heart closer to Islam and to examine Islam, to respect Islam. What type of advice do you have for the not yet Muslim and for the Muslim girls who are sort of scared or lazy to wear the hijab? What can you tell them?
Don't worry about it. Like, you can be walking down the street and you'll be so happy to wear it. It makes you feel special. Like, everyone's eyes are on you. Like, you feel special, not put down. Like, when you're walking with your hijab on, you look up, you don't look down. You have nothing to look down about.
Wonderful. And what about for the not yet Muslims? What can you tell them? You know, you're a 13-year-old Canadian. You were born in Canada?
Yes.
Where in Canada?
Outskirts of Toronto.
Outskirts of Toronto. Wonderful. Wonderful. But what can you tell Canadians not yet Muslims? What can you tell them about Islam? Is there an advice, encouragement?
There's so many things. Like, you'll be able to experience more things. Like, your mind will be open to everything. You'll love it. Like,
so let them examine the Quran.
Yes.
Let their heart and mind examine the Quran. I remember Balqis, mashallah, this year, I mean, you're 10 years old and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took you to the Hajj. You performed the Hajj with your sister Matab, which is nickname Amina. You performed the Hajj and you saw in the Hajj that many people, different nationalities, different languages, different colors. That was an interesting experience, right, Mata Balqis?
Yeah.
MashaAllah. You really look great with your hijab, Balqis. Balqis, my sweetheart, do you remember the time you wore the hijab, the first day you wore the hijab? Do you remember? Do you remember how good you felt, right?
Yeah.
Did anyone force you for the hijab?
No, but I just wanted to wear it. At first, my mom, she's like, she didn't want me to wear the hijab. She's like, you're too young.
Mm-hmm.
And then I told her, I don't really care. I want to wear it for Allah and stuff.
MashaAllah, you know? MashaAllah.
And then there, that day there was a party for Eid party. And then every, like, Eid, every year, they do this little small party for girls who wear the hijab, and that day I went there, and then I saw, like, everybody, like, the girls, they were wearing hijab, and I had this feeling in me, you know, I just wanted to wear it. So then after the next day, I'm like, I want to wear it, and my mom's like, you can wear it if you want, but are you sure? I'm like, yeah. So then I wore it, and then, like,
MashaAllah. This is really interesting, very interesting, that you felt good about it. Mom wants you to wait a little bit. She thought that you are too young. So it means you start wearing the hijab when you're what, in grade?
Grade
four?
I'm not sure, but I think I were in grade three. I started
grade
in
grade three.
I was eight that time.
MashaAllah. Back to Amber. I remember you told me something so beautiful, Amber. And I would like to share this with our audience, respected listeners, with our dear brothers and sisters in Islam and our dear brothers and sisters in humanity, that when you reverted to Islam, when you start praying, the first prayer, you remembered a mean girl. She was mean in the school, and right away you remembered her and you start praying for her. Can you tell me that, please?
There's this girl at my school and she's very mean. Like, you'd think she didn't have a heart. But I prayed for her and, like, to find her heart. And the next day I went to school and I found out she's Muslim. Mm. And she was being, like, sweeter and everything.
Amazing. Do you know, speaking of prayers, a time a person reverting to Islam A time a person declaring the Shahada, it is one of the greatest time to pray to Allah. So this is really interesting that this gear is known as a mean gear, and it happens to come at your prayer that you prayed for her to be nice and to be soft and gentle, and you found your prayers answered. Next day she was a changed person. MashaAllah, that's really interesting, wonderful. Now, SubhanAllah, Amber, tell me more about how do you feel about reverting to Islam. Tell me, how do you feel? How does it feel?
You feel clean. You feel happy. You get so many feelings at once after you convert. It's nuts. Like, you just, there's so many feelings you get.
I remember Balqis told me early on before the interview that when she put the hijab, she felt type of a great comfort, great peace, wonderful feeling that she can't even tell that feeling. She can't pronounce it. She just felt it in her heart. And I go back to the conversation when your sister called me that you want to revert to Islam. I go back to your sister at that moment when you took the phone and I asked you, Amber, are you feeling comfortable about it? You said yes. I said, Amber, is there anyone bribing you? You said no. I said, is there anyone pressuring you? You said no. Are you sure you are with all your mind and sound and you feel good? You said, yes, I feel good. I'm sound. Remember that? You do. Now, I remember so nice and vivid that when you declared the Shahada, when you repeated after me, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. I bear witness there's no God, there's no deity but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. I remember you were crying a lot. Can you tell me why?
There's so many things that hit you at once, like I said. It just, you can't explain it, and you just want to cry. Me and my sister, we cried for like half an hour. We were really happy.
Very happy. That's really nice, mashallah, mashallah. Now I'll tell you something. For us as Muslims, we are a walking, talking Islamic statement. People is watching us. Tell me something about that.
People are watching you all the time. Mm-hmm. When you're walking down the street wearing your hijab, it's like wearing a flag. Everyone sees what you're doing. They see you, like you stand out. Like if your skin's showing, they'll be like, your skin is showing. Like if like it's not supposed to show, they'll be like, they'll point it out just to make themselves feel specialer. I don't know.
So people is watching.
Yeah, and you could be walking down the street and you'll be chewing gum. Mm. You'll want a like piece of gum. Mm. And then you'll take the gum out of your purse and you'll throw the wrapper on the ground. Mm-hmm. People notice, like, and they'll think you're trying to ruin their, like...
The city.
Yeah.
And that will reflect on
all
what
Muslims.
You... All Muslims.
Yes.
Right. That's so true. You know, I'll tell you something really to support your story and support what you are saying. A person, a wonderful brother, reverted to Islam. You know what he said?
No.
He said he used to watch a family, a Muslim family. They are looking good. They look happy. He keep watching them. He's scanning them. They don't know that he's watching them. They look happy. He said they look happy, they look good. He wanna look like them. He wanna look happy, he wanna look good. Every time he tried to copy them, he does the wrong things. And he end up feeling miserable the next day. He wanna feel good, he wanna feel happy. He go and run to the disco, jump up and down, next day feeling terrible and miserable. He said, till a point where I asked, who are these people? He found out they are Muslims. He said, what does it mean? He studied more, he reverted to Islam, he want to look good, he want to feel happy, because they look good, they looked happy. But that's not the end of the stories, my dear brothers and sisters. He says something very important for me and you, really important for me and you, especially living in North America. He said, Muslims, pay attention, you don't know who's watching you. So my dear brothers and sisters, we know, we could give a Muslim or a non-Muslim not yet Muslim. We could give them a book about Islam, small book about Islam, big book. But remember, you are the biggest book and the widest book. If people read through you, proper Islamic treatment, free people read through you, proper Islamic behavior, Islamic moderation, everyone will be influenced. Everyone will be influenced. See, we're living in Canada. To live in Canada and to enjoy the safety and security, it's a great matter. It is a great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to pray daily, sincerely. No cheap talk, no cosmetic talk. We have to pray daily that Allah subhanahu, the Creator, to keep Canada safe and secure, and to keep us in Canada safe and secure, live with dignity and leave to Allah with dignity. Grab with our heart, La ilaha illallah. Amber, let me tell you this. When you say La ilaha illallah, do you know what Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said?
No.
You know who's Prophet Muhammad? The engineer of happiness, the champion of success, the face of glad tiding, the purest of Allah's creation, the best the sun shined upon, the sweetheart for the good hearts. He said, I'll say it in Arabic first. Man qala, La ilaha illallah, مخلصا من قلبه حرمه الله على النار من قال لا إله إلا الله مخلصا من قلبه حرمه الله على النار whoever says لا إله إلا الله sincere from his heart and that means from her heart Allah will make hellfire forbidden upon you so لا إله إلا الله it is a big matter for us in Canada here It is a green land to plant the seed of La ilaha illallah. It is a green land for us here in Canada to invite people to La ilaha illallah, to show our gratitude, to be thankful to the country that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you born here, and we call it home. The country that we enjoy safety and security. One way to thank Allah, one way to thank Canada, to invite Canada to paradise, to invite not yet Muslims, or some people call them non-Muslims, to invite them to paradise, invite them to Islam, invite them to Quran, invite them to understand the honorable, happy life of Islam, invite them to understand that Islam is about peace, Islam is about moderation, Islam is about dignity, Islam is about knowledge, education, Islam is about mercy, tenderness, Islam is about children, respecting their mom and dad, cherishing their mom and dad. Speaking of mom, did mom find out about this happy news? Did she find about you reverting to Islam?
Yeah, I was scared to tell her at first. I didn't think she'd go for it, but she was okay with it. She said it was fine with her, but she also, like, I handed the phone to my sister after, and she told my sister, she said, oh, it's just a phase, I went through that too. And she thinks it's just a phase, but it's not. She's gonna find out like in like a year or whenever she finds out that it's not a phase.
This is really interesting. So basically, she were okay with it, she was understanding. She must be a wonderful mom. She was understanding, she was okay. She's giving you allowance, but at the same time, at the back of your, at behind your back, she is telling your sister that this is a phase that you'll go through. It's just like you tell, but you believe firm in your heart that you want to grab Islam in your heart for the rest of your life.
Yes.
But you know, me and you, we have to pray daily that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is the Creator, to give us the passion in our heart to keep Islam, to keep La ilaha illallah, to give us the stability and the firmness to keep La ilaha illallah in our heart. So this way, it is not a phase for a few months or few years and I'm changed. And speaking of that, again, my dear brothers and sisters, we have to have a support system. Statistics, it's not lying. Statistics showing that people reverting to Islam and they are left behind. They are not facing someone or a group or a center or a community that would really adopt them. So basically, we need to know that those people, Allah honored, Allah guided, opened their heart, penetrated the light of the Quran in their heart. We have a job. We have a responsibility. We have to adopt them. We have to stay to pay attention to their need. We have to listen to their concerns. We have really to give the quality of our time to help them and the quality of our money to build resources and centers to give them the alternative and give them the education, give them the passion, give them the feeling that they are our brothers and sisters. Amber and Balqis, really, this is a very special day that you are here today. This is a very special day and a happy day that you are giving a wonderful message, message of courage, message of pride, message of happiness. You're proud, you're not arrogant, you are proud to be a Muslim, you are proud to wear your hijab, and I remember that so much, that you cried so much out of joy. And it's okay to cry. You cried so much out of joy when you reverted to Islam. And here, I remember Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who's giving the glad news for those who revert to Islam, because we use the word, my dear brothers and sisters, revert. We're not using the word convert. It's not converting to Islam. We use the word reverting because we believe, as Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, taught us, that everyone is born on the religion of Islam, on the religion of nature, Islam. And the parents change that. So basically, they are not converting, they are reverting back to Islam. So to revert back to Islam, to feel good about it, to cry so much that you are really getting that delicious taste. Prophet Muhammad gave you the happy news that you are sin-free, all your sins canceled. Not only that, my brother, if you have a neighbor, if you have a sister, if you have whoever reverting back to Islam, it is not our business to dig in their past. It is not our business to dig in their past. Al-madi lil-qadi. The past is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are sin-free and they are considered a newborn. So, mashallah, that applies to you, and that's congratulations for you. Balqis, can you tell me something else about Islam, about how do you feel growing up? You're born in Toronto, growing up in Canada. How do you feel about, and now I know that you are a good soccer player, right? How do you feel about walking in the street with your hijab, people looking at you, right? How do you feel about that?
You know, sometimes I feel really, I don't like it. You know, sometimes they just look at you in that face, whoa, okay, that's weird, you know? And then I feel bad, I feel like weird, but then one time I was shopping with my mom and we were going shopping in Dixie Mall or Square One, you know? And then people are just like looking at me just because I'm a child, I'm wearing this hijab, or, oh look, she's wearing a hijab, ew, you know? And then I told my mom, and she's like, don't, it's just ignore them. You're very special wearing a hijab and being a Muslim, you know? And then I told her, but there's this feeling in me, I don't like it look like when they look at me and they say, you know, they just make that face. And then she told me, just ignore them. They don't know how special you are. They think you're weird because you're wearing a hijab, but actually you're not. And you're very, very smart, special. You know?
Very special and very smart. Now, I'll tell you something, and this is for my dear brothers and sisters who are watching us. For those also who are not wearing hijab, or for those who are not even converting or reverting to Islam, we don't point the finger at them. We point 10 fingers up to Allah and we pray for them. We point 10 fingers, we pray that Allah guide them. We don't point the finger to belittle them and criticize them. Those who are not wearing the hijab, they're still our brothers and sisters. I mean, those sisters who are not wearing hijab, they're still our sisters. We don't point a finger at them. We point 10 fingers up to Allah and we pray for them. And we point 10 fingers down so we can give them a hand to be courageous as a Muslim. Be courageous to wear the hijab. Be courageous to feel good about your identity, to feel good about following and practicing the Quran.
It's okay. You also, when someone's like looking at you weird, you don't have to get like envious or like mad at them or anything. You should feel sorry for them because they don't get to experience what you do. They don't get to see what you do. Like, they don't see it the same way.
Beautiful feeling. That's a beautiful thought, to feel sorry for them, that they are missing big time on the delicious taste of Islam, and to pray for them. We have to pray for them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, told us a nice, wonderful, big tip, big bonus. At the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he used to say to the non-believers, say la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. It means, say there's no God but Allah, you will achieve success. And really, Islam is about success. Islam is not just looking like a Muslim. The real thing is living as a Muslim. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a Quran walking on earth. He was living as a Muslim and the best of Allah's creation. And looking as a Muslim, it's nice. But the real issue, living as a Muslim. What other advice do you have for the not yet Muslim, Amber?
I don't know. There's so much, like, there's a lot.
Can you tell us some of the advices that you like the not yet Muslims to hear from you?
If you have any feelings at all, like that it's good or anything, go for it, try it. You're gonna end up loving it.
Yes, and I remember that sometimes reverting to Islam, you end up sacrificing certain friends that you don't want to lose, but they end up walking away from you.
You don't have to worry about that, because if your friends are like drinking or doing drugs or something stupid like that, leave them, because in the end, you'll end up with 10 times more in the paradise.
Yes, so right. In paradise and in this life. And I love the way how you are holding hand with Balqis. That's a sign of support, sign of unity, sign of love and brotherhood and sisterhood. And here, Balqis, I want to hear a nice advice for you, a nice encouragement for the not yet Muslims. What can you tell them?
I just want to tell them, you know, like what Amber said, go for it. If, like, let's say there's a sport, let's say soccer, you never tried that sport before, go for it and try it. Like, you'll end up loving it.
Okay, but of course, we don't go for it and try some bad things. But here, if we hear about Islam and if we hear about the Quran, go for it. Let your heart examine that. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Let your mind entertain the thought of me one day being a Muslim and one day wearing the hijab. And it's so beautiful how your sister, Chelsea, which is 19 years old, and also Allah guided her to Islam, both of you from Montreal, and it is so interesting, so beautiful, how she surprised me with this pleasant surprise that Amber want to declare the Shahada, but she want voluntarily, with love and passion, she's in love with the hijab. She want to put the hijab. And I know there is a good brain under the hijab. I know that's heart Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided to Islam. It is a chosen heart. This is a chosen blessing, Amber.
Thank you.
It's a chosen blessing that Allah open your heart to the nur of Islam, to the light of Islam, that Allah penetrate the light of the Quran in your heart. It is a chosen blessing that Allah brighten your face and brighten your life. And we do really wish you and pray, me and ask the brothers and sisters who are listening to us by thousands, I ask them to pray for you, for all of us, that to have stability with Islam, happiness with Islam, to have the proper knowledge of Islam, and really live with La ilaha illallah in our heart. Muhammad Rasulullah, there's no God but Allah, and Muhammad Rasulullah, his messenger, peace be upon him, that we live with dignity and leave to Allah with dignity. MashaAllah. Now, for you, Amber and Balqis, I'd like to see you often in this program, Save a Soul Da'wah production. And we're really happy today to have you. We're so honored, blessed to have you here. This message, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take it to thousands of people and will deliver the benefit into the people's heart. We are after benefit. My dear brothers and sisters, we are after benefit. We are not just after a show. We are not just after a person talking. We are after a benefit. That's why it's called save a soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Whoever helps saving a soul, as if he, and that means she, save all mankind. My dear Amber and dear Balqis, I believe that I could talk to you for hours and hours and hours. You are such a wonderful sweetheart. You're such a wonderful girl. And you have a wonderful message. It's okay to cry. It's natural to cry. It's good to feel good about this special blessing, to feel you are chosen. It is nice to be natural. And for us here, we really like to send another message, perhaps what you mentioned early on today, how to choose a friend, how to have a good friend. Maybe this will be our next interview. Do you have anything final to say to our brothers and sisters who are listening to us? Brothers and sisters in Islam, brothers and sisters in humanity. Islam is about moderation. Islam is about love and peace, about dignity. Give us another reminder, another thought, another good thing you felt. Just tell us something.
Just follow your heart.
Follow your
heart. You have to follow your heart.
MashaAllah. Follow your heart. Wonderful. Now, Amber, at school, I know that people will still come and ask you about the hijab. They will still come and ask you when they see you praying. I'm sure at the school, the wonderful management there at the school, they will give you the room to pray at the time of the prayer. They did already give you the room to pray. Wonderful. We respect this and we pray for them that Allah keep them safe and healthy, that to give them prosperity to guide their heart to Islam. We respect this and appreciate this so much, my dear brothers and sisters, to have this wonderful people to open their hearts and their schools for example, Amber, to pray at the school. They will allow you certain place and certain time to pray. Yes. That's already taken care of. Alhamdulillah. Sincerely, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep this wonderful country, and I mean it, safe and secure.
I didn't get to pray in the school yet, though.
You did not? No. But they already gave you the place.
Yeah, they were willing and free to.
Wonderful. And I'm sure those friends, classmates, you name it, they will come and ask you. And you look at them and you feel that you want to share this joy with them.
Of course.
And you are really aware that it's not rosy all the time. You may have some people pointing a finger at you, laughing at you.
You just have to remember, like, you should feel sorry for them because they don't get to experience it. Like I said, they don't get to experience what you do. Like,
mm-hmm. MashaAllah. طيب. Again, I would love to talk hours and hours with you, both of you big winners. I'm so proud of you. I'm so happy to meet you, Amber. And Balqis, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also for both of you grant you happiness, happy life, healthy, wealthy, prosperity. Tell us something. You feel like you have something to say.
Yeah, I just want to tell you this little short story. It's about my best friend, Aya. I wore the hijab before her, and she used to go to public school, but before she used to go to the same school, I used to go to ISNA. And then, so she went to a different school when I was in grade 4. But alhamdulillah, she used to like visit us all the time. But she didn't used to wear hijab. And then every time I go to her house, she tells me, she's like, because there's this girl in my class and she's just bugging me and saying, oh, look, this girl is Muslim and stuff like that. And then, and she really wanted to wear the hijab, but that girl was, you know, saying really mean things, like she's stopping her. And then I told her, I just forget about her. When you wear the hijab, there's this feeling you're gonna be so happy. Forget about that girl. Maybe she's just jealous of you, that you're so.
You can wear the hijab and still look that beautiful.
Yeah. Sure. And then the next day she came to me and she was wearing the hijab. Actually she called me and she told me, I'm gonna wear the hijab. And the next day she went to school, the same girl, she came and she's like teasing her and saying, ha ha, you know, you're wearing the hijab and you look so ugly and hideous and, you know. And then she came to me and she told me she was crying that time. And then I just said, why are you crying? There's no reason for crying. And then she's like, it hurts my feelings. Like, she's making fun of us and making fun of the hijab. And I'm like, forget about her. So then I told her she was wearing the hijab the next day. And then the girl did the same thing. And then I just told, and she came and she was like so happy. I'm like, okay, something happened to her. What happened? I told her, didn't that girl scream at you or laugh at you or whatever? She's like, she did, but I just ignore her, like you said. And then I'm like, okay. So then she started wearing the hijab and I started wearing the hijab. But after a little while, she left Canada. So.
MashaAllah. Now, subhanAllah, this also will open my mind to another thought, that how by you wearing the hijab, you encouraged others. And you gave not just the look, you gave the personal support to your friend to wear the hijab. And it was a matter of maybe a few days and that girl no longer is bothering her. MashaAllah, 10-year-old Balqis Shehab, and we have Amber, 13 years old. Amber reverted to Islam about, what, a week ago?
Yeah,
right?
Last
MashaAllah.
Sunday.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah. We're so happy, we're so proud of you. We love you so much, both of you. And we will meet again. Jazakum Allah khair. We thank you very, very much. May Allah bless you, protect you, and grant you paradise, all of us, and you too, my dear brothers and sisters. Thank you very much. We will carry on with this particular episode of Save Us All Da'wah production. What's under the hijab? I cover my hair, not my mind. We have Chelsea and Matab for another few minutes, then we will wrap this, inshallah. Again, we welcome Chelsea and Matab. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Chelsea, mashallah, we had your sister Amber with us here today. And we enjoyed this particular pleasure. Nice words, nice experience, amazing, amazing feeling. Can you tell me, please, about the point we sort of got stuck with it? Reverting, converting. Can you tell me more about that?
For reverting to Islam, the reason why we use it because everybody is born a Muslim. Muslim, it means a follower for God, for Allah. And so we don't say converting because it's natural. It's not. There's nothing unnatural about Islam. Just when we're raised in Islam, it's easier to follow the rules. But as we're not raised in it, we have to remember ourselves when we're young. When we're young, we know about Allah, like we feel it, because when we do something, we don't do it like because somebody's gonna see us or something. We know Allah is watching us. We know that Allah is recording our good deeds and our bad deeds. So we're very careful and we don't do good and bad because, we don't do good because we think somebody's gonna see us. We do good because we know Allah is watching us, and we don't need the benefit from the people. As we get older, we start wanting the benefit from the people, and because it's a fast food, you know, it feeds our our pride. Fast food, you know, for the pride, for the happiness, and when we're sick. When we're young, every time we get sick, a lot of people, they still experience this when they get older, even though they say, no, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in anything. But when they get sick and they wake up in the morning and they get sick and they have to run to the bathroom and they're throwing up or something was wrong with them, they pray for God. they don't pray for anything else. They pray to Allah, they say, Allah, help me, please, I'm sick, save me from this, you know. And then after they get better and they forget about it again, you know, because the shaitan is very strong. Like, strong, yes, but not exactly strong, because we open the door. Nothing, the shaitan doesn't come without invitation, you know. And if we pray for Allah, Allah will stop him, or can't stop him. But if it's His will, inshallah, like, God will stop him. But we have to, like, we have to...
To be natural.
To be natural and to be always in good intention. Because even Muslim or non-Muslim or not yet Muslim, doesn't matter. Everybody's judged according to their intention.
Yes.
The only difference between a Muslim and somebody who is not a Muslim is that the Muslim has the knowledge. That's what it means. It means you have the knowledge of right and wrong. But everybody in humanity, everybody has a conscience. And like you were saying before, brother and sister in humanity, that's why we can't treat the other people as different or treat ourselves as we're different. Like, we don't treat a Muslim better than a non-Muslim. Everybody we treat in the same way, and we have to be kind with everybody. We have to care about everybody, because everybody was Muslim. So if your brother or your sister, like from your mother, they got something happened bad with them, you would try to help them, you would try to save them. You wouldn't let them drown. If you see them drowning in the water, you're not gonna stand there and watch and point the finger at them and say, oh, look at him, he's stupid, he doesn't know how to swim. You know, we're not gonna do that. We have to try to save him, and that's the same thing. So we're now, like, the Muslims, we're standing on the ground, the other people, they're swimming, you know, and we have to pull them up. But,
yes,
you know, instead of standing and looking at them and laughing at them, they don't know how to swim.
Beautiful thought. I love that thought. Chelsea, you are a French-Canadian,
yeah.
And reverting to Islam, you know that you keep that identity.
Yes.
You keep that pride. You are a French-Canadian,
yes.
And you are now a Muslim French-Canadian. Speaking of treating them good, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, urged us, وَخَالِقُ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Deal with people with good manners. This is directly from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This does not apply only on Muslims. It applies on everyone, our brothers and sisters in humanity, our brothers and sisters, those not yet Muslim, right? So yes, we have to deal with them with good manners. Now, reverting to Islam, Chelsea, you are 19 years old. I know I'm going to ask you something maybe a little bit tricky. As a woman, a lady, a girl, you know, there's a lots of unfortunate lies against Islam, that Islam does not treat women good, that woman does not have value in Islam, where I believe that the highest value in earth for woman, it is in Islam. Nobody can prove me wrong. I repeat, the highest value on earth for women, it is in Islam. Since you hear some type of Islamophobia and dirty media against the status of women in Islam, and you are a woman, you are a girl, what made you still revert to Islam?
Well, because Islam is for people of intelligence, whether you're a man or a woman. Like, we use not only a feeling. My sister, she got the feeling, alhamdulillah. She's young and she's still very close to her innocence, so it's very easy for her to feel it. Maybe hard for her to explain it, but easy for her to feel it. But for older people, for adults, when they hear about Islam, it's you use your intellect. It's very simple. If you think that it's wrong, without a proof, you can't prove anything is wrong. So if you want to say it's right or if it's wrong, study it, and then you have an argument, you know, for what's your opinion. But until you know what it is, you can't say anything about it. It's as anything, you know. And for the woman, the main issue people have and the main issue we're addressing today is the hijab. Why? Because people, that's the first thing they see, and it's the first thing that they get afraid, because it looks different. But actually, it's very natural. If you take a, like, I'll go back again to, like, a child. You take a young girl and you put her in a bikini and you tell her to go outside, she's gonna get scared. She doesn't want to do it, you know, like and everybody, parents, everybody, I can prove this, I don't have to say it, any parents go and you know, like, I'm not, well, I don't want to tell them to do it, but you know, like, if they've experienced that in the past, they have a daughter or a son or something, like their daughter, they put her like outside the first time, she was afraid, she was shy, or the first time they sent her to school, she was shy, or the first time they put her in front of people, you know, the girls naturally were shy of ourselves, you know, we and the reason for the hijab, there's okay, the first reason I want to say, because everybody right now in the society, they're very big on equality, okay? So we're gonna be honest instead of pretending, okay, man and woman, it's the same. No, it's not the same, it's different, but they need to be treated equally. This is like, Islam does not deny this, but to be treated equally, when a man speaks with a man, he looks at his face because there's nothing else interesting for him, you know? But when a man sees a woman, it doesn't, like, he, whether he's looking at her face or no, he can see the rest, he sees the beauty, and it doesn't mean that he will look at her and he wants something, you know. It's not, as a Muslim man can not talk to a girl who's not wearing hijab, and you know, it's not we're saying men are animals or
how
something.
How do you feel about the hijab?
Well, I just finish this one, like, the, like, a man, when he sees it, he will treat her maybe more nicely. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe it's not, he will treat her like a, like, as he's, he wants something from her, just more nicely, because it's something nicer to look at, something more like kind looking, you know, and stuff like that. So we cover it, so you just see the face, so you treat us, the man and the woman, as an equal. You see the woman, her face, you treat her as an equal, and the man, he will see her differently, her husband, which mm-hmm. is as it should be, you know. So we keep it, like, for the rest of the personality, the beautiful part of the personality, for the husband, for the family, for the girls, but not for the man, because then he will treat us differently, as opposed to, like, as his equal, like, in the, in a conversation sense. And for myself, how I feel about the hijab, the thing I like, because, like I said, we're brothers and sisters, and so I wouldn't, this is what I told for my sister, because we have two brothers. I told her, let's say, for example, my brother, would you like it if he looked at you in a sexual way, or even in anything to do with that? And she told me, no, of course not. So I told her, would you do something for that? I told her, okay, well, what if, so then she understood it, okay, it's not good for the brothers. So then she's thinking, okay, I convert to Islam, these are my brothers in Islam, so I cover, so that way they will respect me as their sister. But then I told her, okay, but you, it's for the other people too, because let's say your brother, for example, he did something bad, we disown him from the family. So after, is it okay for you to marry him? Is it okay for you to let him to look at you in a wrong way? Of course not. And
you mean, so, brother in Islam?
No, I mean, like, my own brother, just to make her understand what it is. Because brother in Islam, or blood brother, we have to treat them the same. We have to treat everybody well, you know. Of course, we're human, like, we have the feeling we love our own family more than the others. Mm-hmm. But our duty for Allah, because Allah loves our brothers, we have to care for them, you know. We have to care for each other so we will be stronger. So the men that they're non-Muslim, it doesn't matter. They're still our brothers, because they were our brothers when they were born. They're just, they got misguided along the way. And that's all. We can't look at them like as they're not our brothers, just they're our brothers and they're misguided. So even my own brother, my blood brother, if he's doing something really bad, I can't stay with him. You know, I can't, and this is like a Muslim or non-Muslim, they will understand it. If your brother, he doesn't have a respect for you and he's treating you badly, you will leave the room. You will not stay with him. If he's swearing on you or something like that, you will not stay there. Mm-hmm. So anything that's in disrespect, we treat everybody, we have to treat them as they're our brothers and sisters. Some are the good, some are misguided, but we have to care about.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Now, Chelsea, tell me, Dad, I asked Amber, your sister, asked about Mom. I want to ask you about Dad. How did he feel to see his, at that time, I think you were 18 when you reverted to Islam?
Yeah.
You were 18.
Yes.
Right, so a year ago. Now, how did Dad feel about his teenage gear, his sweetheart, wearing a hijab and reverting to Islam? What did he say? What did he feel?
Actually, my dad, without knowing, he's the one initially who showed me what's Islam.
Wow.
Because my dad is, mashallah, my dad is the most honest, I think so, most honest person like I know. My dad is very, very important for him to be honest in this life.
Amazing.
And not only with other people, but with yourself. And my dad comes from a Catholic family.
Mm-hmm.
But my dad, he did not baptize me and he did not teach me to be Catholic. He let me learn about it because I chose to. I wanted to learn about it when I was young because I saw the other kids at school. I went to Catholic school and I wanted to see. Mm-hmm. But my father, he taught me to be honest. So you see what's the truth. And you look in this life and you try to find the truth in it. So my dad, when I told him about Islam, he saw that there was no lies in it because everything in Islam, it's a proof. And my dad didn't force me to be Catholic because he doesn't want to lie to me because in his heart he knew he doesn't want to lie to his daughter and tell her this is the right because he was not sure, you know. So he didn't find it, so he let me find it. He allowed me, he gave me the way to go out and find what's the truth.
Wonderful.
And once I showed it to him, nothing in Islam is without proof. That's one thing that the people, they don't understand. You know, they think we do it, we're based merely on faith.
Mm-hmm.
But that's
mm-hmm.
not like the Prophet Rasulullah Sallam and Allah Subhanallah, like he knew in this generation to be based on faith, it would be very difficult, possible, but difficult. And Allah is very generous. Very generous, so he sent us the Prophet Rasulullah Sallam to show us all the knowledge, and not only that, to give us proof, to prove that what he's saying is true.
Honest.
Because Allah knew that in Honest. The more and more as we go in the future, people want proof, they want solid proof.
Wonderful.
So he sent us the Prophet Rasulullah Sallam. He was 40 years old, no education, and he was describing how the universe came to be. He was describing the earth. He described the oceans. He described the ocean. It's one side is sweet. One side is salty, it's split down the middle. This is existent on this earth. They discovered it in science today. And one side is sweet, one side is salty, split right down the middle. Try to take a bowl of water and put sweet water and then salty water and try to separate it down the middle without anything. Try to do it and then after explain to me, first, how the Prophet, he knew this. Second, how somebody will do this. Only Allah can
Allah
make this.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed.
Allah subhanAllah, he said that on the whole earth, everything is a sign. And not only that, there are some signs that are bigger than others, that are more open than others. So with all this proof, we can't deny the truth.
Now, see, I could talk to you hours and hours and hours. You're a very interesting person, smart person, and really courageous. But we have about 3 minutes of the program, maybe less. Just give us a quick advice, a quick reminder for the Muslims, for the not yet Muslims, girls, boys, men, ladies, what can you tell us?
Well, especially in this society, everybody's very big on education, mm-hmm. right? So educate yourself on what's the point in being here. This is a short life. If you base your education only to make a career and invest in this life, that's fine, but this life is gonna be over. So what are you investing for? We all feel, we in our conscience, we're investing for something, but we're investing for something to end,
wonderful.
This is wrong.
Wonderful. So you're telling them, invest in the knowledge of knowing what's the purpose of our life.
Of course.
Wonderful.
This is the test.
Yes.
You do good, you go in the Jannah. You go do bad, you will be punished. And that's what we deserve. We deserve everybody the test. So that way, when whoever will make it to the Jannah, inshallah, everybody, when we will meet in the Jannah, then it's fair. Everybody got there fair and square. They were tested
right.
And they made
we
it.
We have less than a minute to go. I really enjoyed wonderful talk with you, wonderful
okay.
thoughts, and we will have you for more time.
Inshallah.
I will tell my dear brothers and sisters, remember, there's so many candidates out there, good, great Canadians, not yet Muslims. invest the quality of your time and money to build these centers to welcome John and Mary, George and David, welcome them to Islam. Open your heart, invest in the alternative for those newcomers. Help them, support them. Jazakumullah khair. A listener can be much better than a speaker. We will get together in another episode of Save a Soul Da'wah production. Jazakumullah khair. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.